So, the Pirahã are a small tribe in the Amazon, and they don't have number words. Though they have a concept of amount, they can't actually count. According to anthropologist Daniel Everett, when trading with outsiders, they simply point to things until they're satisfied with the exchange or the trader is unwilling to give more. The key thing about Everett's work, though, is that he doesn't see this feature in isolation. He sees the lack of counting as a part of a web of several unusual features in Pirahã, such as lack of color words, lack of embedding, and the persistent monolingualism of their tribe in spite of their contact with other peoples for over 200 years. Persistent monolingualism isn't just a problem among the Pirahã, though. In fact, something like 56% of the world's population is still monolingual. But this problem can be solved, and that's why this video is sponsored by Babbel, one of the top language learning apps in the world. Now, I'm not monolingual myself, but I love learning languages. I really haven't been motivated to for a while, but I find the structured but flexible approach Babbel provides makes it way easier to get going and keep at it. So I'm going to learn Indonesian.
Selamat sore, Ibu Santi.
Selamat sore, Ibu Santi.
Selamat sore, Ibu Santi.
Yeah, that's what I said. So, like, I basically speak Indonesian now.
And that's just one of the 13 courses to choose from. Look, you can even learn Swedish on here.
Hey. Hey, do.
Whether it's for travel, work, or because you need to impress that really hot foreign person, Babbel is the app for you. With lessons made by real language teachers, it is designed to get you the skills to have practical conversations about the topics you're likeliest to encounter in the real world. And if all that isn't enough for you, well, Babbel offers a 20-day money-back guarantee, so why don't you give it a try? By using my link in the description, you can get 60% off your subscription, so make sure to check out Babbel and comment below what language you'd like to learn. Thank you to Babbel for sponsoring this video. In the last video, I compared Everett to Worf, and I did this because it's a seemingly easy comparison to draw, and because some of those working off of Everett's theories are, in my view, clearly neo-Worfian. But the thing is, Everett himself thinks Worf got it all the wrong way round. He doesn't believe that the Pirahã language intrinsically changes the Pirahã understanding of the world, like Worf did with the Hopi. No, language changing the culture isn't what Everett's work is focused on at all. Everett is talking about the culture of a people having an effect on their language. This is what begins to go against the theories of Noam Chomsky. Chomsky is one of the most influential linguists of all time, hands down. He has been described as the founder of modern linguistics by some. One of Chomsky's theories, his thing, if you will, is universal grammar, or UG for short. So what is UG? Well, that is a very difficult question. How about we start with the works of Roger Bacon? In around 1945, he wrote his book Overview of Grammar, based on a series of lectures at the University of Paris, and argued for an early form of universal grammar. Sorry, did I say 1945? I meant 1245, just a slight mistake in my script there. Bacon argues that human language in fact has a common grammar with only minor, incidental variations between individual languages. There have been many similar ideas of universal grammar throughout the history of European linguistics. But what distinguishes Chomskyan universal grammar capital U capital G from its predecessors is that it is a biological theory of language acquisition. The basic premise of UG is that we have an innate biological faculty which defines and restricts the bounds of human grammar. When raised under normal conditions, children develop language which conforms to a set of syntactical rules predefined by the structure of their brain. You could look at some studies like Valiant's 1986 observation of young children, where the toddlers seem to subconsciously assign words into syntactical classes to do with what places those words occupy in sentence structures, rather than semantic classes to do with the meaning of words. Hence, all languages follow the rules of an underlying biological universal grammar. Chomsky's first theory of UG, proposed in the 1960s, was very specifically defined, and though I won't go into it too much here, I will say that it was essentially completely based off of a common grammar between European languages, and, well, Chomsky himself soon saw the problem with that one. Therefore, in the 1980s, Chomsky and his colleagues reworked UG into what is perhaps its most well-known model, the principles and parameters approach. This posits that all languages follow common principles, which are to be determined by empirical investigation, and their grammars are then defined by a set of switches, which can either be set to on or off. An example of this would be the pro-drop parameter. Some languages, like Spanish, allow subject pronouns to be dropped from a sentence, with phrases like tengo hambre, which has no pronounced subject, being completely grammatical. This means the pro-drop switch in Spanish is on. In English, the phrase "am hungry" is not grammatical, so the prodrop switch is off. That is, an explicit subject is required. So culture and environment affect how children speak, with these parameters being switched on or off in their brains according to how they see the language around them used, but it never defines the limits of what can be said. This is the first major clash between Everett and the Chomskyans, cultural principles that Everett believes underlie the Pirahã language. One such principle is that of immediacy of experience. Everett argues that features such as the grammatical structure he calls immediacy of information encoding, which, for instance, prevents embedded structures, are caused by this cultural emphasis on the immediate and the experiential. Everett is saying here that what the Pirahã are able to say is constrained by their cultural values. This is a highly controversial claim, to say the least. Linguists were losing their shits over it. Some accused Everett of being primitivist or Eurocentric, and I mean, the more I've read Everett's work, the more I've noticed these strange tendencies he has. He always talks about a Pirahã, one of the Pirahã, stripping them of their individuality, hardly ever referring to them by name, and I think that's kind of racist, I'll say it. But what does that prove? That Everett's a prick. As I said last video, it's not an argument against his arguments. However, I think linguist Andrew Pauly makes a very apt point here. How does Everett know that the Pirahã language can't express non-immediate ideas? Is it not possible that it could grammatically, but that its speakers choose not to because of Everett's defined cultural constraint? But believe it or not, this deep philosophical debate is tame and uncontentious compared to an argument about sentence structure. The principles and parameters approach to UG was reworked and edited for decades. See, when researchers tried to find the universal parameters by studying non-European languages, the data just didn't seem to fit the model, or the revised model, or the revised model. The problem was there were just too many exceptions and outliers, and the model was getting stupidly complex trying to accommodate all of them. Then in 2002, Hauser, Chomsky, and Fitch published a paper which simplified UG down to its bare bones. They argued that there was one single, uniquely human component to the faculty of language, essentially a universal grammar which is governed by one principle: recursion. Recursion is where something is defined, directly or indirectly, in terms of itself. So let's take a definition of a sentence. A very quick, rough definition that holds fairly well for English at least would be an utterance with a noun phrase and a verb phrase. So, the man likes the dogs, noun phrase here, verb phrase here. But what about the man thinks the dogs are cool? We have a noun phrase, the man, and verb phrase, thinks the dogs are cool, but the verb phrase itself breaks down into a verb, thinks, a noun phrase, the dogs, and a verb phrase, are cool. And what did we say an utterance with a noun phrase plus a verb phrase was again? That's right, a sentence. So we have a sentence within a sentence. This means that sentences can be of arbitrary length because you could just keep saying the man thinks, the dogs think, the cats think, the women think, with no grammatical restraint. The way I like to think about this is Russian dolls, just sentences inside sentences inside sentences. And sentences aren't the only recursive structures in language. Look at genitives, for example. I could talk about my brother's friend's sister's college's headmaster's pencil. I could actually just go on and on. Russian dolls. I could have a noun phrase within a noun phrase. The big blue buildings contains the noun phrase big blue buildings, which contains blue buildings, which contains buildings. Russian dolls again. Recursion allows the construction of infinite grammatical sentences in any given language. But in Pirahã, you can't say my brother's friend's sister. You have to say my brother has a friend, this friend has a sister. According to Everett, there's no embedding, there's no subordinate clauses in Pirahã. All there is juxtaposition. You can't say, I watched the foreigner fishing. You have to say, I watched the foreigner, he was fishing. Even if we analyze these utterances as part of the same sentences, there's not one inside the other, they're equal statements. Not Russian dolls, but rather, two branches. Everett's claims are once again controversial. A 2012 corpus study on this found that they couldn't find any evidence for recursion in Pirahã, but also that it couldn't be ruled out. Everett maintains that the Pirahã have recursive thinking and information processing, but that this simply doesn't manifest itself in their language. I want to re-emphasize that the verdict is still out on whether or not Pirahã has recursion, but Chomsky has not waited for those results to come in, and neither will I. He responded to Everett's claims by calling him a charlatan. Apart from personal attacks, he did make a few arguments. Firstly, Chomsky argues that it is impossible for Pirahã not to have recursion because recursion is the essential component of the language faculty, a theory Chomsky invented. So as far as I can tell, Chomsky's argument is that the Pirahã must conform to his theory because his theory says so. Right. Secondly, Chomsky argues that it wouldn't even matter if Pirahã didn't have recursion because there is no alternative to universal grammar. It's just the biology that underlies language. What am I even supposed to say to this? This is pseudoscience. Now, I doubt Everett is right about everything. As I said in the last video, he is the one non-Pirahã who speaks Pirahã. We need more people to do fieldwork and test his theories. But if this language really doesn't have syntactic recursion, then that's it for UG. That's the final blow. This whole business has shown how shaky the ground is upon which universal grammar stands. One could say that it's in fact been dying a slow death, gradually falling out of the mainstream as old scholars hang onto it and new evidence contradicts it. If UG is just the biology that underlies language, then what? Then the criticisms scholars have been throwing around for decades are correct. UG amounts to basically nothing but the simple statement that humans learn languages, and humans have grammar. And that's not an explanation of anything, it just begs the question of why that is. If UG can't make evidence-based statements about the world without referring to itself as evidence, then it becomes untestable, unfalsifiable. Everett once asked Chomsky what predictions universal grammar makes, how one would test it, falsify it. Chomsky said that it doesn't make any predictions, that it can't be tested, because it's a field of study, like biology. Now, sorry to be all prescriptivist about Chomsky's language here, but I think in academics, precision is important. Strictly speaking, UG is not a field of study. It's a paradigm. And paradigms shift.